Hey everyone, welcome to Write On, the podcast from Final Draft. This is the show where we talk about all things screenwriting. I'm your host, Phil Galasso. Today's guest is Jesse Chatham, co-writer of the new movie Land, directed by Robin Wright. Wright also stars in the film as a bereaved woman seeking out a new life off the grid in Wyoming.
You ever get lonely out here?
Sometimes. I know I'd be more lonely there than here. That may sound... It doesn't make any sense, but...
It does. It does to me. If you don't want to talk about the past, have you thought about what you want your life to be now? Moving forward?
I want to notice more. Notice everything around me more. Know more about here, be able to survive here, appreciate it.
Sounds like a goal. You are able to live here now. No more cell phones, no more traffic, no more holiday celebrations.
Special guest host Shardae Sellers talked with Jesse about the script's themes of isolation and loss, its journey to the screen, screenwriting contests, and more. Check it out.
Hey everyone, I am here with Jesse Chatham, and he is one of the co-writers of the new feature film, Land, coming to theaters February 12th. Hi, Jesse.
Hey, how are you?
I'm quite well. I don't know if this is a proper way to start the interview, but I want to tell you, your movie reminded me a lot of Taylor Swift's new song called Cowboy Like Me. Have you heard it?
No, I don't think I have.
It's on the Evermore album, and it is a sensational song. And it was giving, as soon as I watched your movie, I was like, this is the music video that she needs to do for the song.
What's the name of the song again?
Cowboy Like Me.
Cowboy Like Me. Okay. Mm-hmm. I will listen to it right after we finish up here.
Great. And you can thank me and Taylor Swift later.
Okay.
I want to ask, okay, so we're Final Draft. I want to focus on the screenwriting of this, but first of all, let me just say, this film is gorgeous. You've seen your film, right?
Because yes,
I know some writers don't get to see their film.
Right. I know. Right. Yeah, I've seen it like three times, I think. So I want to see it in the theaters, but I'm a little, I'm not sure I'm going to risk it, to be honest here.
Where are you calling in from today?
In Boulder, Colorado.
Oh, but you guys have such beautiful landscape. Just look outside your window.
I know. I know, absolutely.
Play in the living room and look outside your window.
There you go. There you go.
You don't need to go to a theater. Did you make it to set, by the way?
I did. I made it to set for like 36 hours. That was in October of 2019. Flew up there to Calgary. It was like the mountain environment and the cabin were like an hour away from Calgary. And it was really fun to go. It was a beautiful set. The mountain was 8,000 feet. So it was like really up there.
The air is fresh and crisp and not poisoned.
It was. It was freezing cold too. I had to borrow extra stuff from wardrobe. So it was like, it was freezing cold, but it was, you know, it's just pristine too. It's beautiful.
I'm going to ask you about writing this film, but I need to know because it was boggling my mind as I'm watching it. I'm like, did you guys stay for all four seasons or did you bring in snow? Like, how did you do this?
Yeah, no, they shot it in like 30 days. So they did fall, right? So they got, I think they started early October or late September with the fall colors, and then the snow would come in oftentimes quickly out of nowhere and could just cover the area in snow, and then the warm weather could return and then the snow would melt, so you would have your opportunity to do more warm weather shots. So it was really funky. I mean, Robin's talked about how challenging it was to, like, because they'd have to switch wardrobes too. Like if they're doing fall and then winter's coming in like 5 hours, they go and do wardrobe to do the winter clothing, all that, get back out there, shoot that. And then, you know, the next day they're back doing fall or even summer, actually. I think we're trying to get some of those shots as well.
It was insane to watch because I'm just like, did they stay for 6 months? Like, I'm putting the pieces in my head. And then I'm like, well, that's just free set design. That's great.
Yeah. When I wrote it, I thought it was going to be shot like that. I mean, I didn't know much about how they made movies. So I thought they'd have to do, I thought they'd do either like spring, summer / fall, winter. Like, I thought they would do two different shoots. But like, logistically, that was difficult. Financially, it was difficult. So they made it work. And I'm sure they did some like, you know, special effects on some of that. You know, some of the snow, I think, was a little bit, you know, CGI stuff to a degree. But I thought it looked really natural, the whole movie. Like, it seemed like they were out there for, you know, for a long time.
It did. And I'm from Michigan, and I live in LA now, but I do miss like outdoors and trees and weather. Yeah. So it was nice to see it.
Yeah.
Let's go back to something that you said. You said you weren't sure how they made movies. So let's talk about your experience as a screenwriter and how Land came to be.
Well, my story kind of starts in 2013. I just turned 40. And I was unhappy with kind of where I was. I was doing internet marketing and that sort of thing. And I had already always written, you know, I was always writing something, but it was never really screenplays. And I was never finishing anything. I was writing novels and not completing them. Short stories. I was in a band. I was doing all the lyrics. And I kind of had this moment of mortality, a sense of mortality. And I was like, you know what? Like, I should think about what I want to look back on when I'm, you know, 65, 70. Do I want to look back at a life that, you know, didn't take any risk, didn't go for it, go for the dream, or do I want to just kind of be comfortable, you know, and kind of have that life, you know? And for me, it was just like, I finally decided, like, I just want to go for it. So that started the screenwriting stuff. And Land was my third feature that I wrote. There were two others before that and a pilot. And Land just kind of, it was called Island at the time, spelled I Land without the S, kind of a playoff of John Donne's No Man is an Island or No Woman is an Island. And it kind of just came to me, you know, after a while. I kind of just spent time thinking about that story. We were living out in the country a little bit. We were living in Denver proper. And then we had our first child. And so we moved north of Denver to some, you know, a little bit of land. And I started thinking about what it would be like to disappear, what it would be like to isolate yourself completely from the world, who would do such a thing, what kind of, you know, motivation would it take to actually do that, you know, to truly set yourself apart from everyone. And also hoping, you know, an Edie, Reed really doesn't want to ever see somebody again either, you know? And I think that was a key part of the story was trauma, which would, I think, it was the impetus for her to move away. And then isolation, where she didn't want to be around humans anymore. It was too risky to love. It was too dangerous to have relationships with people. Those things can go, those things can, you know, die, be destroyed. And that's kind of how that story kind of started rolling. And it probably took me about, I'd say the first draft was like, God, I don't know, 3 months, 4 months. And then of course, that's just the first draft and draft after draft, as you know, I'm sure. But
yes.
It takes many drafts to get to a place where you feel comfortable sharing it with people. But yeah, that story was written in 2015 for the most part.
And then, I mean, I know the development process, and I know putting together feature film is like, we could talk about that for 2 hours, but long story short, how do we get from, hey, I want to write about isolationism and again, loss and grief to now Robin Wright is going to star and direct a movie.
I know. I'm still trying to figure that out. It's pretty remarkable. Well, I mean, the short story is that I entered it into the 2016 Nickel Academy Award or contest, and I placed in the top 50, somewhere in there, I'm not sure where. And one of the readers, Laura Kennedy, was a VP of casting at Warner Brothers, and she read it and she fell in love with the script. And she was able to lasso in a woman named Alan Stewart, who was just on Sully. And that took about a year just for that to happen. From Laura and I to talk to Alan kind of being involved was about 9 months, you know, to 12 months. And then, you know, Alan was busy with other stuff. So it took some time there. I think Robin came on board in 2018, summer of 2018, which is now we're looking at like two years from the contest. And then that took another year, I think, or less than a year, but it took some time for her to decide that she thought she was just gonna direct it, but she actually decided to star in it as well. And that was partly due to difficulties just getting other people's schedules, other actresses. They did send it out to some great actresses, but ultimately it was Robin that took it over. And I'm so glad she did. I think she did a phenomenal job directing and acting, crushed it. And I think too, it was like such a challenging work environment to be up in the mountains. I mean, she lived up there too. And the weather was really cold. And she was living up there for like 30 days in her trailer, just being in the environment. I mean, she really busted her ass for this movie. And I don't think a lot of people were probably as willing to devote themselves to that, to that level, you know, but she did it. And I'm so grateful that she did. So anyways, so basically 2015, write it, 2016, kind of gets discovered a little bit. They finished it in 2019, pandemic hits, so they can't release it in 2020. So here we are in 2021, finally going out.
Overnight success. Overnight success.
Yeah, in Hollywood, right? That's kind of true.
We did it. We did it, Joe. No, you know what, Jesse, it's so fun. I love doing these interviews because I find my kindred spirits. I think you and I share like a twin soul, because I had the same experience where I was like, fed up. Looking back, I wasn't where you are with kids or anything, but I was, you know, I want to do something. Entered a contest, didn't win, came a finalist, but that's how I got my first.
Yeah.
So I always encourage writers to say, don't just think about the win, think about the eyes that can be on it. So you're a testament to that.
Yeah, awesome. Absolutely. I mean, I think placing is always helpful. I mean, you know, you have to have some bona fides happen at some point for the managers and the agents and so on and so forth, producers, to pay some attention to you. But I think at first we're all in the same boat. We're all just starting to write. A lot of us are, you know, not writing great stuff right off the bat, and it takes time. And you just kind of go slowly with it, or as fast as you can, but it still feels slow. And you know, things I think often do happen. I mean, I think that there's this idea of like hard work versus talent. Like which one is, you know, the most beneficial? And I don't know. I mean, you can kind of say hard work might be, I mean, I don't know. I don't want to get into that.
That's another hour.
Right. But I think ultimately both is the best.
Both. Yes. Hard work, settle on that. Talent.
That's the safe answer.
We won't give you percentages, people, but you need both. Well, I'm gonna circle back to this question at the end of our interview, but I want to touch on it now. You started a little later than usual. I'm not gonna say that later in life, because you're still very young, but later than usual than most writers. I think that it's really important that I ask this question, because a lot of people will ask me like, well, I'm 40, I have kids, I can't do this. And I'm like, it's actually one of the best jobs to have, because it doesn't matter like what age you are. You could just write something great. So do you feel like had you had written Land in like your 20s, that you would have the same discipline that you do now with being a father and a husband? And
I don't know. I mean, I think that probably not. I think that if I was going to do it, I would have done it back then. I was busy doing other things, you know, hanging out with people, being in a band, partying, which is great stuff to do. But like you said, I mean, you do get to a certain age where you kind of take account of your life a little bit. And I also don't think I would have been able to write Land. I think there's a certain maturity to writing something like that. And what I mean by that is that you need to have some sense of what it's like to have a child, maybe, and the idea that you could lose your child or lose your spouse. And I think that takes perspective, and that might be earned by aging on some level. Maybe, I'm sure there are people that could write something at 25 like that, but I don't know if that's, I don't know if that's the norm. So I think for me, it was definitely like, it just wasn't my time. And I'm a late bloomer in life. I always have been. I always like catch up and then, you know, get stuck. Just like in 10 years, I don't know where I'll be in 10 years. Hopefully, you know, I'll be wiser and more mature and all of that. But No, but I think that was a movie that I needed to write at that age. I could have written thrillers and some other stuff, I think, maybe in my 20s or early 30s.
Yeah, like I do.
Yeah.
I mean, there's something to be said, again, kindred spirits. I don't have children, but I have an empathy with my mother, who the way she talks about me and my siblings, similar to how you feel about your child and similar to Robin Wright's character in the film. It's just like, why am I here if it's not for you guys? Like, when you guys go, there'd be no reason to be here.
Right.
Which was one of my favorite scenes, because I'm close with my sister the way the character in the film is with hers, or at least she was before. And when she looked at her sister, and I'm not going to cry because it's going to bring up sister bonding things. When she looked at her sister and she said, "Why am I here?" Oh my gosh, that got me, because I just imagine if my sister said that to me, it would rip my soul apart.
Yeah.
And Robin, like you said, is just classically so freaking on point with her delivery. It's not overdone. Mm-hmm. It's just, it hits you in the head.
I think Robin's remarkable. I don't know that she's gotten the credit she deserves. Maybe I really hope she gets nominated for this. There's so many moments like that too, that are just about loss and what do you do if you're so unfortunate for something like that to happen to you. And again, I think that's just another perspective of the difference between a drama like that and a thriller. And I love thrillers and I write thrillers. I'm working on one right now and I'm really excited about it. But there's a more emotional kind of, I don't know. I don't want to offend any 30-year-old writers that are saying, "Hey man, I can write that too." And I'm sure you can, but for me at least.
It's a different point. Yeah. I could write that too, but would I be connected to it as if I wasn't a mother? No, there's a different connectivity to it, having children.
Right.
Which I want to ask, because I want to ask two things. I would definitely want to follow up on that thriller, so don't let me forget that. But the first thing I want to ask is about, we find out at the very end of the film, or towards the third act of the film, that she lost her young child and her husband to a random open shooting.
Right.
Which was very cathartic, because in our country, America, if you're listening to this other places, it's a very real reality. There are a lot of people who are going through that. So what was that decision like when you were writing, I'm writing about loss. Did you always know it was going to be, they were going to go that way?
Right. Yeah. I mean, I always knew I was going to do a mass shooting. You know, Robin changed things up in terms of where she started the movie and jumped over some of the things that she felt wasn't necessary. And I think it really worked. In my drafts, though, earlier on, we were actually kind of seeing a shooting happen. We were kind of in that moment. She was at the mall, it was Christmas time. She's downstairs in the parking area. I would just hear just shots ringing out. So I wanted to make it really visceral. Maybe I did it too much though, because I don't know if everybody wanted to see that, but it was definitely, I wanted it to be something as random as that. Her husband and her son were getting, hot cocoa at a coffee shop, about to go see a matinee of Elf, the movie. Something really just ordinary, and how from that normal moment comes something horrifying and terrible. And I wanted it to kind of be Edie was not only traumatized by that, but she was kind of giving up on humanity in a way too, kind of giving up on how risky it is to, or in her mind, to love people and to be connected to people. Mm-hmm. And, the mass shooting just seemed a little bit more extraordinary than a car accident. I would think the grieving process would be a little different. Mm-hmm. if you've lost your family in a car accident versus in a mass shooting. There seems to be something especially terrifying and horrifying about losing somebody in that manner. And it's funny, I've had a lot of people ask me, well, why did you choose a mass shooting? Do you have some personal connection to it? And I don't. I don't have that personal connection, thank God. But I do think when you're a writer, we have to get inside characters that we don't always have personally relate to that experience that they're having. But with all the mass shootings that happen in this country, I mean, it felt like a good thing to cover. And I know Robin's going to mention that too, how we had I don't, we've had less during the pandemic, but for years, I mean, we were having them almost every week.
Yeah.
It was a pandemic of mass shootings happening. So, mm-hmm. But yeah, that was the inciting incident up to that point, or that was the inciting incident. And then, you know, she reveals it at the end in the movie, which I think was really cool. She wanted to keep it kind of mysterious. She wanted to kind of keep it, you know, like, why is she up there? Why is Edie up in these mountains apart from everybody, you know, in the world?
No, I liked it because, like, we know, I knew immediately she'd lost someone. I speculated it was a child or a husband, and then it was both. And I was like, okay, yes, but why would you never want to see people again? So when she revealed that, yeah, I would do the same thing, hun. And I always think about the parents of Sandy Hook, and my brothers, they're twins. They were the same age of those children that day. And I go, I don't know how those mothers and fathers just don't isolate themselves, just like this movie. Right. Like, I don't know if I could ever be around people again. So I think it was a really beautiful choice and a great input on Robin's half to like cut that scene out, because it just made it, it actually made it hit a little more for me to go, oh man, yeah, now it all makes sense. So you're working on a thriller right now, but I'm not going to ask you what it is because you're still working on it. So we're not going to do that. But I wanted to just let you know, yes, Land is a drama, but it is to me like a nice thriller too. It could be a horror. I mean, because she's got the bear scene, she's by herself, she's almost dying, and she's lost. Right. She lost her family. I was like, this is a scary movie. This is an adorable.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's, I've heard the word intense a lot. You know, even with the earlier stuff that I'd written in those earlier drafts, I mean, it was intense. Like having a mass shooting scene is really intense. And, you know, I think that all the things that she goes through are very intense, very challenging, very hard, very painful. Life is not easy for her at all. And, you know, even when we get to the ending, which I think is really redemptive, but it's still not easy. I mean, you know, I'm saying it doesn't end. Nothing is easy in the film for Edie. Yeah. I think it's a very challenging journey for her, but redemptive and life affirming. But I also feel like it is intense. And I think in that way, you could say maybe it's like a thrillery kind of vibe, because what's next? Like what hard thing is she going to have to deal with next? And all of that stuff. So that's kind of a cool thing to say. I appreciate that. I haven't thought about it like that, but it's
I mean, like, what else is scarier than losing the people you love and then all your food as a bear jumps in? Or the scariest thing, I guess, is just like giving up. That would be the scariest thing for me, like giving up on myself. And Edie fights so hard. To her credit, she's fighting and scrapping in every scene, and I love that she's. People say she's giving up, like her sister and her family, because she's leaving and going to this woods, but she's actually fighting to stay, I think. So it's such a beautiful tale. Okay, so I want to wrap up with this. We ask all of our guests the same question. So here you go. I kind of touched on it earlier, but not really in depth. If you had advice for your younger writer self, so three scripts ago, what would that be?
I mean, I think that you have to just have faith in this journey. You don't get a lot of approval easily. A lot of people don't want to read you. It's hard for people. It's hard to get people to read you. It's hard to get people to care about you. And that's really disheartening, I think. And, you know, it took me three years to get a manager, my first manager. And then it took, you know, a couple more years to get an agent. And I just think it's just this journey. You have to celebrate the milestones. You have to, like, hopefully you have somebody who encourages you in this journey. My wife is that person. My wife, I would never be doing this without my wife. She's remarkably supportive of me and always has been. And so I know that's the number one thing is find a Julie, my wife. But if you can't find her, celebrate the moments, keep believing, keep writing. Write the best you can, get better. Hopefully you can just each draft and each script, you can get better. And, you know, I think good things happen. I think you keep knocking on those doors and you keep working. And that's what happened with me. You know, like, you don't plan for somebody to be a reader in the nickel contest who contacts you afterwards, who has connections, who wants to make this movie. Like, you don't know when or if that's going to happen, but you can enter the contest. You can vet your material with a great screenplay analyst. You can do all of those things in hopes of putting yourself in a better position for success.
Kindred spirits. I mean, because it's a long game. And isn't the it? Advice, yeah, the advice that you're giving, I know some people are listening to it like, oh my gosh, just write. That's the advice. But that's the advice because it's true. It's like, have patience and keep writing.
That is absolutely like, I mean, it's not sexy sounding at all, but that is the nuts and bolts of it. Unfortunately, it's not, I mean, I do think that they come though. When you start writing stuff and you get your name around town, you'll start getting people that want to read you, producers, you know, other agents, managers, et cetera. So, you know, stick with it though. It is a long game. That's such a good way of saying it. There's no short game. It's not a sprint. It's a marathon, man.
May us all have the strength of Edie to fight off bears in winter in the mountains of Wyoming after losing our children. Like, if Edie can do that, we can write and be patient.
Totally. Totally.
All right. Well, Land comes out in theaters tomorrow as we're recording this, February 12th. Are you going to, well, we talked about it. You're not really gonna go to a theater.
I do have an N95 mask, so I could mask up, go in there, sit in the back.
I mean, it's your first feature film on the big screen. I don't know. I think I gotta go.
I know, right?
I think I would go too if I could do it as safe as possible. Like, buy out the theater, I guess. Go in the morning for a matinee show. And just really soak it in. I look forward to seeing where you go from here. And I look forward to Robin, like you said, just getting all the acclaim that she deserves because she is so, so talented. And it was a pleasure speaking with you.
Me too, Shawnee. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thanks to Jesse Chatham for coming on the show, and thanks again to Sade Sellers for guest hosting. Land is in select theaters where it is safe and drive-ins February 12th. And of course, thanks to you, our listeners. If you liked this episode, leave us a review, and if you haven't already, subscribe on Apple, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcasts. For news about future episodes and more, like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter at Final Draft Inc., and on Instagram at Final Draft Screenwriting. This episode was produced by Kayla Guess with help from associate producer Emma Vranich. Music is by Santiago Arias. Thanks again, everyone. Until next time, right on.